For part four, we'll be talking about measures of central tendency. This is just different ways of talking about where is the center of a distribution. So how we calculate the center of a distribution really kind of just depends on what we're after. In some cases, it's obvious, and there's not going to be any question what the center of a distribution is. In this example here, we have a histogram, but I just traced the outline of the histogram, so you don't see the individual bars. And this will be pretty common in the course. So I have this histogram, and you see that it's kind of mound-shaped and only has one hump. And the center seems to be right at the top here. And there's really no question about it. That is the center. This is a symmetric distribution, and all symmetric distributions, the center is going to be very obvious, and there's not going to be a question. But what happens if we have a distribution that's a little crazier? This distribution seems to have a high point here like the other one did, and I apologize for the squiggles here. I drew this by hand. But then it has this kind of long tail at the end. So where's the center? Is it here, or is it here, or is it here? It's not entirely clear. So that's what the focus on this section will be about, is what do we mean by center? What do we mean by average? So the first type of central tendency we'll talk about is the mean. While the mean is often called average by people, when everyday people say the word average, sometimes they're referring to the mean, and sometimes they're referring to something else. So just to be clear, instead of using the word average, we'll try to use the word mean instead. So to find the mean or the average, we're just going to add up all the values and divide by the total number of values. As far as symbols go, this technique's going to be the same whether you're talking about a sample mean or a population mean. But for a sample mean, we're going to use a different set of symbols than the population mean. So let me show you. So for a sample mean, we're going to use the symbol X bar, and that's just how it's pronounced. It's a lowercase x with a bar over it. Of course, we're using x because that's our variable, but keep in mind if our variable was y, we'd call it y bar. But anyway, usually we use x, so we'll call it x bar. And to find our sample mean, we just add up all the x values and divide by the total number being the sample size, or lowercase n. Keep in mind I've mentioned the symbol dictionary in the last set of lectures. You want to make sure you create the symbol dictionary. There's going to be about a dozen or so symbols we use over and over again throughout this course, and you want to make sure that you don't forget what symbol means what. So lowercase n for sample size should be in your symbol dictionary, x bar should be in your symbol dictionary, and possibly even f for frequency should be in there. All right, similarly, we have the population mean. For the population mean, we have the symbol mu, kind of like a cat sound, mu, mu. Sort of. Anyway, it's spelled MU if you were to write it out in English, but it is a Greek letter, just like the capital sigma was a Greek letter as well. So we use the symbol mu to indicate that it's a population mean. And notice how it looks. It looks kind of like the letter U with a tail in the front. All right, so to find the population mean, you're just going to add up all the x values just like before and divide by the total number, again, just like before. But to indicate that we're talking about a population, we're not going to use lowercase n because lowercase n is the sample size. We want to use capital N, which is the population size. The median, our textbook uses M or capital M for median, but it doesn't have to be M. I've seen lowercase m as well, and some books just don't have any symbol at all. So don't worry so much about this M. I'm not going to be using it very often. But the median is the point where approximately 50% of your data falls below that point and 50% falls above. It's literally dividing the data set in half, where half is below and half is above. It's also called the 50th percentile or the second quartile. We'll explore that in a few more sections. So to calculate the median, first you're going to sort the data from lowest to highest. If there's an odd number of values, you just take the middle number. For example, if there's 13 numbers in your data set, you are going to take the seventh number, because for the seventh number, six are going to fall below and six are going to fall above. If you have an even number of values, I left off an S there, you're going to take the middle two values and average them. So for example, if we have six values, you're going to take the third and fourth value, because two numbers would fall below and two numbers would fall above. So you'd take those two middle values and average them. and that's it. All right, so let's find the sample mean. So consider a sample of hourly wages of 5 workers. These hourly wages are measured in dollars or dollars per hour, and the first one's making $14 each hour, next one $12, $10, $13, and finally $17 an hour. So the sample average would be, we'd add up all those numbers, 14 plus 12 plus 10, etc., and notice my symbol I'm using here, and divide it by the total number, which is 5. So if we add up all the numbers, we get 66, then divide it by 5, we get 13.2, or $13.20 per hour. For our sample median, again, we have our same sample. Let's sort that. So 10 first, 12, 13, 14, then 17. And then we take the middle number, which is just 13. Notice here that our median is $13 and our mean is $13.2. That's pretty close. It's not always that close, but it's always nice when it is, because then there's really not much of a debate about what the center is. So let's consider another example. Same data set, but I added the number 45. Maybe I threw in a manager into this sample here. So in this case, our sample mean would be the sum of all of our x's divided by n. So it's the same sum as before, but I'm adding 45 to it, which gives me a total of 111. And this time I'm dividing by 6 because there's 6 people. That brings the average to $18.50. All right, just pausing for a moment to look at this. $18.50, that seems kind of high if you think about it. In fact, all of our workers are, well, 5 out of our 6 workers are actually making less than $18.50, and only one of them is making above, and the one that's making above isn't making anywhere near $18.50. So while this $18.50 may be the mean, it doesn't seem very descriptive of our sample at all. Now, related to the median, first we have to sort our data just like we did before. Now the two middle numbers, our two middle numbers are 13 and 14. So let's average those two middle numbers, 13 and 14, divide it by 2, add them up, divide by 2, and we get $13.50. That's pretty close to what it was before, and this seems to be a little more descriptive of our sample. All right, and notice how big the difference is. So why is there this big difference? So in our first example, if you remember, our median went from $13 to $13.50 in our second example. But the mean increased by a lot. It went from $13.20 to $18.50. This happened because of that outlier, that one very large observation. The mean was really impacted by that one outlier, where the median hardly changed at all. It only changed by 50 cents as opposed to several dollars. What our conclusion is that this outlier or very unusual observation, means are going to be very sensitive to outliers. In other words, a very large or a very small number is going to grossly impact an average or a mean, but an outlier isn't going to affect a median very much at all. So this is just some thought that you can use to when you post on the forum this week if you decide to. Clearly, the median describes a typical worker better. So why would you ever want to use the mean over the median? There are times you might want to use the mean over the median. That's why we use mean so often. But why would we want to use the mean over the median? So think about it and post your thoughts. There's no right answer here. And I'll probably chime in later in the week as well. All right, our third measure of central tendency is called the mode. A mode is just the most common observation. If several of them are tied, then there are multiple modes, and if none of them are repeated, there are no modes. So let's look at this first example. Suppose we have the numbers 5, 8, 5, 5, 4, 4. Since 5 is repeated 3 times, and 4 is only repeating twice, we can say 5 is the mode. On our second example, 10, 16, 10, 16, 8, both 10 and 16 are repeated twice, so they are both modes. In example 3, we have 9, 8, 7, 1, 6, 4. Since none of these are repeated, there is no mode. One thing I'd like to point out, that in a case where we have two different modes, we often call this a distribution bimodal. You can also be trimodal or whatever else, but bimodal is one of the more common things that you might see in statistics and are usually kind of an interesting situation. Another way we use modes is to look at a histogram. So graphically on a histogram, the mode is going to be the highest point. If there's only one hump, it's said to be unimodal. And if there's two distinct humps, it's called bimodal. So here's an example of a unimodal distribution where there's one hump and the mode is right at the top here, the highest point here, and it's whatever this value is for x. For a bimodal distribution, we have two separate humps. And even though these humps aren't exactly the same size, even if they're somewhat close, we see that there's clearly two separate humps, so there are two modes. Bimodal distributions are really one of the more interesting things that might happen in statistics, because this indicates that there's something funky going on, that maybe there's two different groups of people being analyzed here. Maybe it's men and women and there's some kind of discrimination. Or maybe we just included two different populations by mistake and we need to split apart our sample. Like maybe we accidentally grouped the managers and the regular workers together and we should split it apart since they're from two different populations. So often histograms are one of your first steps when you're doing a sample or when you're analyzing a sample, because it indicates really what direction you should go in your research. All right, so a skewed right distribution, sorry about the weird order there, but this is actually the same picture as before. So we notice here that this distribution has this kind of giant tail to the right. This giant tail to the right indicates that the distribution is skewed right. Skewed right meaning that the mean is to the right of the median. And this is happening because only a few very large observations all the way over here are pulling up the average. So this happens often with salary data where you might be including like one manager and it's bringing up the average like we saw. And notice the mode is still going to be in the high point. The median is going to be pretty close to the mode usually, and the mean is closer to the tail. So skewed right means tail to the right. Skewed left means the tail is to the left, or more formally, it means the mean is to the left of the median. I happen to see this a lot when looking at test scores, where I might see a lot of test scores in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, and then there's always one or two students that seem to get like in the 30s or 20s or 40s because they just didn't study and they didn't realize there was even a test that day. So this often happens with test scores, and they bring down the average. And that concludes